the first reading and that of the Gospel. They both deal with the mystery of death and resurrection. Some would say the afterlife, if there is any such thing possible. It's a curious thing, as well, most people would want it to be possible, but they have little faith that it can't be. It's impossible. One of these things is even beyond, as it were, the undoing of the Lord. There are two examples. One was of a prophet during the old dispensation, one of the most famous of all, Elijah, who brought back to life the child of his widowed mother, who was giving him lodging during a great famine of seven years. And the widow was, as it were, terribly discouraged. She thought they were free of any further disturbance when she took Elijah in, and when they were almost out of food, on his guarantee that the Lord would provide a complete flour bag and a complete jug of oil, so they could always have good bread in the house. And with good bread, you can survive any famine, as long as it doesn't give out. And now everything seemed to be gone. And Elijah said, "Now let's not be insensible about these things." He understood and appreciated the bitterness of the mother. Mother, put yourself in her place, and probably you'd be inclined to think along those lines. What is giving here? The prophet took the child upstairs where his rooms were dead. And he prayed over him to the Lord, and the Lord gave him life again. He brought him downstairs and gave him to his mother. And she was, as it were, enlightened, and she saw indeed a great man is here. Great because she gives us, as it were, not only knowledge of salvation, but is able, as it were, to bring that to be in, at least in part. No more fasting during the famine. Amen. Down. Our Lord referred to this once in a visit to his hometown Nazareth, and he also referred to the cure of leprosy of the Syrian general, the only one during a time of a terrible plague in Israel, and as well. Saving precisely this woman's child in what we call that part of Asia, near the Near East, that is known as Lebanon. Our Lord referred to this, and he said, as well, there were how many potential widows and dead soldiers, and the Lord has sent no one to raise them from the dead, but only to someone of the Gentiles, in Sarepta of Sidon. And the same thing was true with the Syrian general who was cured of leprosy, with all the lepers in Israel and Judah. Now one of them was cured miraculously during this time. And why? Because they had no faith. Wasn't that because these people were more holy than the Jews? It was because they had something that is called faith, or the basic makings of that. And to show his mercy, and to relieve them of their strain, those signs were worked by Elijah. Now our Lord is, as it were, during his public ministry, also raised many from the dead, and nobody knows how many lepers he healed. And all of these are signs of the healing of the leper, the forgiveness of sin, to be able, as it were, to live in a holy life, to believe, to hope, and place one's trust entirely in the great prophet. That meant something to the Jews. The great prophet was the one promised by Moses, greater than Moses himself, as the one who would be, as it were, the Messiah, the promised Savior of the world. Hence, the conclusion of this little episode is a very important one for us, because in modern times, as in ancient times, the the difficulties are the same. Lack of faith, lack of belief and trust in the teaching of our Lord, and the fact that he can guarantee his teaching by the miracles that he works. And who is guaranteeing him ultimately with this? It is the Heavenly Father. These are the works of God. It does not need, as it were to a politician or a scholar or anybody else, although that is acceptable if they wish to give witness to the goodness and the kindness and the greatness of our Lord. But here we come closer, as it were, to what this miracle, raising from the dead, but not, as it were, permanently, verbally, what does it point to? It points to the resurrection of Jesus and the resurrection that he guarantees us if we are but faithful to him. And this resurrection is complete for us at the end of the world. But in the meantime, what our Lord said concerning those who receive worthily Holy Communion, who eats of my flesh and drinks of my blood, will not die. I will raise him up on. I will still be living. What will be restored? The unity of soul and body. In the meantime, even on this in this life, the life that we are living now transcends the natural life that we enjoyed before we came to believe and hope and walk in the footsteps of Jesus. The life that we are leading now is a divine life. It is a supernatural life. It is the life of grace, sharing in the life and the joy as it's already before we have died and been corporally risen from the dead. We need oft to meditate upon these things, dear brothers and sisters. It's one of the reasons that our Lord gave us his own mother as our mother, so that she would continue, as it were, to give you, me, you, and all of us, as constant indications of the reality that our Lord makes possible for us. He is the Savior. He is the only Savior. But he is the Savior who can save us with a life that will never end, a life that we share with the divine persons in heaven. And this is what Our Lady, as we will constantly remind us, she will intervene, she will anticipate all our difficulties in one way or another. All it is necessary that we have recourse, and even when we don't have recourse to her, how often it is, and she remembers the praise and the thanks that we have given to her and through her to Jesus. Let us never forget that. And we will find, as the word, that the joy we receive in communion is that much greater. And the assurance that we go ahead keeping his commandments, risking our lives indeed for him, is not a waste of time. That we should not, as we make the first conclusion of the widow of Sarepta of Sidon, but it's the conclusion that is important for us. It is the importance for us of understanding the joy that was brought to the widow. Indeed, she underwent a sorrow, but the sorrow, as it were offered for the Savior. As a kind of an extension, a sharing in his suffering on Calvary, is not a waste of time, is not without its concrete fruit. And I, if you eat of my flesh and drink of my blood, God will not die. That means you will not lose, first of all, that supernatural life that guarantees the fulfillment of the promises, and that you will find, notwithstanding the sharing in the suffering of Jesus, a great joy, to know that at the at its foundation, it is something that that shows the life that he has given to us is a truly reasonable one, a one which is truly oriented to our blessedness forever in heaven. Heaven enables us, as we're to do so many things to help others, to care more for the things of heaven, the things that pertain to eternity rather than the passing pleasures of this life. If we have to make a choice, and here is the final practical conclusion, if we have to make a choice between what God promises, what our Lord in so many instances has shown he is capable of fulfilling, to those things, as it were, that at the most can only be described as passing pleasures, things that one day will disappear and leave us penniless, spiritually speaking, for the rest of eternity. So let us thank our Lord and His Holy Mother for the help they have given us, and ask them to help us always to remember, be deeply thankful, to praise the Heavenly Father for the stupendous love He had for all of us and each of us. That though we were in sin, He sent His only begotten Son, His beloved Son, to be a propitiation for our sins, and the author of a new life for us, even before we pass from this world to the next. Praise be Jesus and Mary.
Fructum ventris tui.